Welcome back to Deep Learning. So today we want to discuss in the last part about weakly and self-supervised learning a couple of new losses that can also help us with the self-supervision. So let's see what we have on our slides. Today part number 4, and the idea is contrastive self-supervised learning. So in contrastive learning, you try to formulate the learning problem as a kind of matching approach. So here we have an example from supervised learning, and the idea is then to match the correct animal with respect to other animals. So the learning task is whether the animal is the same or a different one. And this is actually a very powerful of training because you can avoid a couple of disadvantages in generative or context models. So for example, pixel level losses could overly focus on pixel-based details, and pixel-based objectives often assume pixel independence, and this reduces the ability to model correlations or complex structures. So here we essentially can then build abstract models that are also built in a kind of hierarchical way. Now we have this supervised example, but of course this also works with many of the different pseudo labels that we've seen earlier. So we can then build this contrastive loss, and all that we need is the current sample x, some positive sample x plus, and then negative samples that are all from a different class. In addition, we need a similarity function S, and this could, for example, be a cosine similarity. You could also have a trainable similarity function, but generally you can also use some of the standard similarity functions that we already discussed in this lecture. Furthermore, you want to apply then your network F on X and compute the similarity, and the goal is then to have a higher similarity between the positive sample and the sample under consideration and all the negative ones. This then leads to the contrastive loss. Sometimes this is also called the info-normalized cross-entropy loss. And there's also other names in literature, the n-pair loss, the consistency loss, the ranking-based NCE, and so on. It's essentially a cross-entropy loss for an n-way softmax classifier, and the idea here is that you then have essentially the positive examples, and this is then normalized by all of the examples. Here I'm splitting the two still in the first line, but you can then simply see that the split is actually a sum over all of the samples, and this then yields a kind of softmax classifier. So minimizing the contrastive loss actually maximizes a lower bound on the mutual information between F and F plus, as shown in those two references here. And there's also, of course, a common variation that introduces a temperature hyperparameter that is shown in this example, so you divide by an additional tau. The contrastive losses are very effective, and they have two very useful properties. On the one hand, they align, so similar samples have similar features, and on the other way, they create uniformity because they preserve the maximal information. Let's look into an example how this can be constructed, and this is a reference 31. So let's say you start with a mini batch of n samples. Then each sample is applied with two different data augmentation operations. Then this leads to 2n augmented samples. So for every sample in the batch, you get two different augmentations. Here we take t and t prime that we apply to the same sample, and you know that this sample is then the same. And your transformations t and t prime are taken from a set of augmentations t. Now you end up with one positive pair for each sample and 2 times n minus 1 negative pairs, because they're all different samples. And then you compute a representation through the base encoder F that then produces some H, which is the actual feature in presentation that we're interested in. And an example for F could be like a ResNet 50. Then on top of this, we have a representation head G that then does an additional dimensionality reduction. And note that both G and F are the same in both branches. So you could argue this approach has considerable similarities to what is called a Siamese network. So you then obtain 2 different Zs, Zi and Zj, from G. And with those Zs, you can compute your contrastive loss that is then expressed as the similarity between the 2 Zs over the temperature parameter tau here. And you see this is essentially the same contrastive loss that we already seen earlier. Contrastive losses, of course, can also be combined in a supervised way. And this then leads to supervised contrastive learning. And here the idea is that if you just perform the self-supervised contrastive, you have positive examples versus the negative ones. And with the supervised contrastive loss, you can then also embed additional class information. So this has additional positive effects. So let's see how this works. So let's summarize a bit what the difference between supervised learning, contrastive learning, and supervised contrastive learning. Well, in supervised learning, you would essentially have your encoder that is shown here as this trapeze. Then you end up with some description that is a 2048 dimensional vector, and you then train a classification head that produces the class dog using the classical cross entropy loss. Now, in the contrastive learning, you would then expand on this. So you would have essentially 2 coupled networks, and you have the 2 patches that are either the same or not the same with a different augmentation technique. And you train these coupled weight-shared networks, produce 2048 dimensional representations, and on top you have this representation head, and you use the contrastive loss on this representation head, not directly on the representation layer itself. Now, if you combine the 2 into supervised contrastive, you essentially have the same setup as in the contrastive loss, but on the representation layer, you can then augment an additional loss that works strictly supervised. And there you still have the typical softmax that goes to, let's say, 1,000 classes and predicts dog in this example, and you couple it on the representation layer to be able to fuse contrastive and supervised losses. So the self-supervised has no knowledge about the class labels, and it only knows about 1 positive example. The supervised has knowledge about all the class labels and has many positives per example. This then allows you to compute a loss between any sample Zj having the same class as the anchor Zi. So the 2 classes are the same. And this leads to the following loss. You can see this is still based on this kind of contrastive loss. Now we explicitly use the cosine similarity, just using the inner product of the 2 vectors. And you can see that we essentially add the red terms here that tell us to essentially only use cases where we have different samples. So I is unequal to J, and we want to use samples in this loss where the actual class membership is the same. There's a couple of additional things that you have to keep in mind. The vectors Z, they need to be normalized. This means that you want to introduce a scaling where this W is essentially the output of the projection network, and you scale it such that it has a unit norm. And this then essentially leads to something that you could interpret as a built-in focal loss, because W is going to be high for hard positives and hard negatives and small otherwise. So for 1 positive and 1 negative, by the way, it turns out that this loss is proportional to the Euclidean difference between the actual observation and the positive minus the Euclidean distance between the actual observation and the negative. So this is, by the way, also a very common contrastive loss in Cyanese networks. Let's have a look at the hyperparameters. It turns out that the supervised contrastive loss is also very stable with respect to hyperparameters, and you don't see these large variations as if you were using only supervised cross-entropy loss in terms of learning rate, in terms of the optimizer, as well as in terms of the augmentation. If you're interested in the exact experimental details, please have a look at reference 33. What else? Well, the training is about 50% slower than with the cross-entropy loss. It does improve over training with state-of-the-art data augmentation, like CutMix, and it enables unsupervised clustering in latent space, and this allows them to correct for label noise. It also introduces new possibilities for semi-supervised learning, and so on. Is that it? Are there no more ideas? Well, there's also some interesting idea that is called bootstrapping, self-supervised learning, and you could argue that this is a paradigm change. This is a very new paper, but I'm including it here because it has some very interesting ideas that are very different to the contrastive losses. So it's called bootstrap your own latent, BYOL, and the problem that they observe is that the choice of pairs is critical. So often you need to have large batch sizes, memory banks, and custom mining strategies in order to get those pairs right. And you also need to have the right augmentation strategy. So in Bootstrap your own latent, they don't need negative pairs, they don't need contrastive loss, and they're more resilient to changes in batch size and the set of image augmentations compared to contrastive counterparts. So what's the idea? Well, they have a similar setup here. They have this kind of network that does view, representation, projection, and prediction. And now the idea is that they have an online and a target network, and they interact and learn from each other. Now, of course, this is problematic because in theory, there's a trivial solution possible, like zero for all images. So what they then use to counter that is they use a slow-moving average of the online network as the target network. And this prevents from collapsing all weights to zero very quickly. As loss, they use the mean square error of the L2 normalized predictions, and this is proportional to the cosine distance. So it's quite interesting to see that this very simple idea actually outperforms the state of the art and self-supervised learning. So you can see here colorization and different ideas that we talked about in the beginning. And with their approach, they outperform even SimCLR. So quite interesting to see that. Also, in terms of number of parameters, they are very close to supervised learning in terms of ImageNet top one accuracy. So they get very close to the state-of-the-art performance. And actually, I'm quite interested in seeing whether this will also be transferable to other domains than ImageNet. And in particular, it would be interesting to look into such approaches on medical data, for example. I have some further readings for you, and you see that with the self-supervised learning, we're very, very close to the state of the art. And this is a very active field of research. So let's see how these approaches will develop in the next couple of months and years, and which of the approaches will be considered as state-of-the-art methods in a couple of months from now. I have a couple of blog posts here for you that are quite interesting in terms of self-supervised learning. And yeah, of course, we are now slowly going towards the end of our lecture, but there's still some things coming up next time. And in particular, next time we want to talk about how to process graphs. So there's also something which is a very nice concept called graph convolutions. And I want to introduce you to this topic in one of the next videos. And another emerging method that I still want to show is ideas how to avoid learning everything from scratch and how to embed specific prior knowledge into deep networks. There's also some very cool approaches out there that I think deserve being presented in this lecture. So I have plenty of references in this presentation. So you see that we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 pages of references. And this was, of course, very quick. So I will also put it into the description of this video. So thank you very much for listening and looking forward to see you in the next video. Bye bye.